Good morning, everybody. My name's Matthew.
My name's Phoebe, and this is our daughter. What's your name?
This is Chloe, and Bluey as well. As we begin our service, we would like to acknowledge that we gather on land traditionally cared for by the Wurundjeri people, and as a church, we recognise the ongoing need for justice for Indigenous people.
A special warm welcome to the members of the Ringwood, Heathmont, Croydon and Croydon North Uniting Church congregations who are also joining us this morning as we celebrate the anniversary of the Uniting Church. Please, everybody, make yourself known via the chat and let us know where you're from.
There's a prayer button at the bottom of the screen. This is the confidential prayer that you'd like a member of the North Ringwood prayer support team to follow up. If there's something you'd like prayer for and you want everyone to pray, just post in the chat.
There's also a giving button on the screen. This is for North Ringwood Uniting Church members who'd like to contribute financially to the church during this time. We're aware that this might be a challenging time for some members, please don't feel pressured at all. If you're visiting our service or just trying to find out who this Jesus fellow is, then please know that this service is our gift to you. Members of other congregations should refer to the giving processes that they have in place and not use the giving button here. Come here.
After the service, there will be a virtual catch-up via Zoom. The link will appear automatically thanks to the tech team in the chat. So pop in with your tea and a biscuit and enjoy some virtual fellowship.
Thanks to everybody who's been keeping this online service running, and we hope you enjoy the service today. Bye.
Bye.
You say bye?
Bye.
I wonder if you were there at the very beginning of the Uniting Church back in 1977. Or even before that, as part of one of the three denominations that came together to form the Uniting Church. Do you remember the bold and exciting dreams of that time? Do you remember some of the struggles of bringing the new church to birth? Do you remember the celebrations and the marches between the different churches on that very first Sunday? Do you remember the high expectations of what this new Australian church would mean? Or perhaps you were born after 1977 or came to the Uniting Church since the time of union. Can you remember what led you here? Whenever you came, whatever you remember, you're here now and you're most welcome. In these recent days, as we reflect on history and our interpretation and perspective on history and how some of our thoughts are being rightly challenged, it's interesting to reflect on the journey of the Uniting Church over the last 43 years and what has led us to where we are today. So this morning, let us offer thankfulness for the good memories, for the stories of faithfulness, for the positive engagement with our communities. But let us also pause to remember and reflect on the challenges, the struggles, and the disappointments as we attempt to find a realistic middle ground as we enter our time of worship this morning. Let us pray. God, who brings light into the darkness and life to all, be with us today as you are with us always. Bless us as the body of Christ, the church, as we meet alone or in small groups in our living rooms. Send your Spirit among us to inspire our reading, our praying, our remembering, our wondering and our celebrations. May it be so. Amen.
Showed me the way through your loving
message of love. New life as a servant, shown what must be done. You stood for justice and peace for us all. Help us, we ask you to answer your call. Breathe on us, your spirit of love. Breathe on us, your spirit of love. Sometimes we turn away from your love. Sometimes we stumble and fall. But you're always there when we return, sharing your love for us all. Sharing your love for us all. Oh Jesus, you have the answers to how we should live. To all that we take and to all that we give. You are our beginning and you are our end. Our master, our servant, our savior, our friend. Breathe on us, your spirit.
No one likes having an argument, right? Normally we try our best to avoid arguments, to prevent conflict, because no one enjoys having fights, especially if it's with the ones you love most, our friends, our families, or even our church. But sometimes, doing the right thing means arguing for something, like fairness, like kindness, like love. There have been lots of people throughout history who have had arguments in order to stand up for what is right. People for whom it might have been easier just to stay quiet, to just keep the peace. But they couldn't do that. They chose to do what is right. People like Martin Luther King, people like Gandhi, people like Mary McKillop, and people today like Adam Goods, Greta Thunberg, and Malala Yousafzai. People who argue for kindness, for care, for fairness, for love. But these are people who have been criticised, who have been told to stay quiet, not to disturb the peace, because what they are saying means that maybe we might be the ones to change. And sometimes, we don't like to hear that. Jesus warned his followers that sometimes following him would be hard. Sometimes following Jesus and living for kindness, fairness, and love would make some people angry. In fact, we know that it made some people so angry that Jesus himself was killed by those who disagreed with him. And yet, Jesus never stopped arguing for what is right, to love God and love each other. And Jesus wasn't afraid to disturb the peace. If it was peace that was being held together by ignoring some people or mistreating others, Jesus knew that God's peace, or shalom as he called it, was only created through kindness, fairness, and love. And sometimes that's worth fighting for. This week, we acknowledge the birthday of the Uniting Church, which was formed in 1977. At that time, this new church made the following statement.
We affirm that the first allegiance of Christians is God, under whose judgment the policies and actions of all nations must pass. We realise that sometimes this allegiance may bring us into conflict with the rulers of our day, but our uniting church, as an institution within the nation, must constantly stress the universal values which must find expression in national policies if humanity is to survive.
Let us pray that the Uniting Church in Australia can continue to find the courage and follow Jesus to be prepared to argue for kindness, fairness, and love.
Today's reading is Matthew 10, verses 24 to 39. Now, this is really Jesus giving a pep talk to his disciple as they prepare for their missionary outreach. But it's not the rah, rah, rah of the footy coach. It's more of a reality check. In a series of seemingly disjointed statements, Jesus is saying this to his disciples and his followers. Disciples and followers. Do you really know what you are getting yourself into? You had better be ready for what is coming at you. Jesus begins. The student is not above the teacher. Now, I like the way Jesus starts. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is not enough for students to be like teachers and servants like their masters. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebub and other foul names, how many even worse names will you, the members of my household, be called? So do not be afraid of the people out there. For there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or there's nothing that hidden will not be made known. But, shh. Now listen carefully. What I tell you in the dark, you must speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim it from the rooftops. Do not be afraid of those who can kill the body, but they cannot kill your soul. Rather, be afraid of our God, who can destroy both the soul and the body in hell. Now, consider the birds.
Well, the birds then.
What birds?
Any birds.
Why?
Well, have they got jobs?
Who?
The birds.
Have the birds got jobs?
What's the matter with him? Says the birds are scrounging.
Oh, look, the point is, the birds, they do all right, don't they?
Well, good luck to them.
Yeah, they're very pretty.
Okay, and you're much more important than they are, right? So what are you worrying about? They are, see?
And even the very hairs on your head are all numbered. So do not be afraid, because you are worth more than even the sparrows. Now, if you stand up before others and say, I am with him, I follow him, then I will also acknowledge you before the Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown you before my Father in heaven. Do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to turn a man against his father. I have come to turn a daughter against their mother. I have come to turn a daughter-in-law against a mother-in-law. The members of your own family, they will be your worst enemies. Anyone who loves their mother or their father more than me is not worthy of following me. Anyone who loves their son or their daughter more than they love me is not fit to follow me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of following me. Whoever finds their life will lose it. And whoever loses their life for my sake we'll find it. And Jesus finishes. Is this really the gospel of our Lord? Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Rapid swell beside. As I have been reflecting on today's gospel reading, I was thinking maybe that it should come with a warning. I had in mind one of those big yellow triangles, hazmat, hazardous material. Some of what is in today's reading is hard to hear. We don't seem to be in the presence of the gentle Jesus we maybe are more comfortable with. But here we are with a Jesus who speaks to us of bringing a sword rather than peace, who asks us to choose between him and our fundamental loyalties to parents and children, who asks us to lose our lives so that we might save them. This is hazardous material. Our tendency is to want to gloss over it, explain it away. But maybe we need to dwell here a while and come to understand that following Jesus is hazardous and does lead us into dangerous territory. The passage we have read from Matthew's Gospel follows on from the reading last Sunday, where Jesus names and commissions 12 apostles. He sends them out to the villages and out there to be on about the things that Jesus was on about: healing, restoration, bringing new life, and proclaiming the nearness of the kingdom of heaven. In what precedes the reading we heard this morning, Jesus has given his disciples instructions. He's told them to travel light and trust God to provide. He's told them to minister to those places where you find a welcome. And when you don't, shake the dust off your feet and leave the rest to God. Expect to be in dangerous territory. Expect to be in the place of wolves. Expect to be disappointed, to encounter betrayal. And so don't be naive, but rather be wise as serpents and as peaceable as doves. When you are arrested, detained, brought before authorities, trust that in this time of crisis, the Spirit will speak through you. In what we read today, we see how if we share in the same mission as Jesus, how if we are on about the same things as Jesus, then we should expect that in the same way we will share in the aggression and anger that is directed at Jesus. If they call Jesus Beelzebub, that was the prince of all the demons. If they call Jesus Beelzebub, don't be surprised if you're counted as fellow demons of his household. If we share with Jesus in proclaiming the reign of God, we will also experience the anger and violence of those who are threatened by the reign of God. Jesus did not preach himself, although who he was and what he did was clearly a central part of the gospel. Jesus' preaching was about the inbreaking, the nearness of the kingdom of God. The claim that Jesus is making then and now is that God is ruler over all things, that God's rule is rooted in justice and righteousness, that we are invited to participate in God's reign and begin to experience the promise of life in abundance, a different way of being, a life lived in relationship with God, as Jesus shows us is possible, a life released from captivity to sin and self-interest. The invitation to participate in this kingdom is without condition, but it does require of us one thing: that we accept the invitation. If we're heading off in pursuit of other gods, other interests, other priorities, other loyalties, then we need to do just one thing. The scripture calls it repent. But literally, it just simply means to turn about and enter in to the invitation that's been offered. Once we participate, we discover that this kingdom is all embracing, that it claims every part of life, that it offers fullness in every way. But it must come first. That's what makes other kingdoms and empires and regimes shake and grow angry and become violent and tag Jesus and the believers with all kinds of names. Because these other kingdoms cannot accept that they do not have a total claim upon us. They will call us all kinds of names. We know some of them are familiar, and I hear them from friends in other parts of the world. We feed the poor and they call us communists. We heal the sick and they say we're possessed with a demon. We challenge their unjust laws and they call us terrorists. We proclaim a kingdom of righteousness and justice, and they tell us that we're being politically correct. We're just virtue signaling. We're just a bunch of bleeding hearts. In the light of the kingdom of God, the grubby, seedy, corrupt, self-serving, dark corners of every other regime are exposed for what they are. Don't worry, the scripture tells us. All that is now hidden in dim back rooms, concealed by misdirection or covered up by blatant lies, all that is hidden, all that influence that is being bought and sold will be disclosed. What is hidden will be brought to light and made known. There's no need for concealment. There's no need to keep things hidden, to speak in hushed voices. What Jesus has to say is not secret. Shout it from the rooftops. What's heard in the dark? Bring it out into the light of broad daylight. No wonder the powers shake and resist. No wonder that they plan to kill those whose loyalty is with the kingdom of God. I know many people of faith in other parts of the world who are under constant threat because they are on about the things of Jesus, because they will not shut up. They will not keep quiet. They will not stop shouting about corruption and injustice. I can now count more than 30 friends and people I know or have worked with in the Philippines who have been killed because they would not stop being on about the things of God's kingdom. I've had my life threatened because I have been on about the things of the kingdom. When we approach life by seeking first the kingdom of God above every other loyalty, we enter into hazardous territory. But Matthew tells us, assures us, that we never enter this hazardous territory alone. We're embraced by the intimate care of God, and we hang together collectively as members of a kingdom community, what Paul calls the body of Christ. Next Tuesday, on the 23rd of June, the Uniting Church in Australia turns 43 years old. I was reflecting if in these 43 years our collective witness had made the powers shake and resist. I was reflecting on when the powers tried to silence us, when they planned to kill us because of our loyalty to the kingdom of God. I could think only of a few occasions. Mostly we've been tolerated or ignored. Sometimes, yes, through the grace of God, we have been able to exert influence for greater justice. Have we lived lives that witness to the promise of abundant life? Have we extended the invitation to others to repent, to turn around and consider seriously God's invitation to participate in God's alternative way of being in the world, the way that's shown to us through Jesus Christ? Yes, sometimes we have. But I don't really see the crowds catching a glimpse of the kingdom and rushing to storm the doors of our churches. I don't want to diminish in any way the amazing things that the Uniting Church does in so many areas: local mission, social services, efforts at personal faith sharing and evangelism, the covenant with the United Aboriginal Islander Christian Congress, education, hospitals, intercultural ministries, international partnerships, etc. There are great things that are happening. But are the powers shaking? Are they raging against the kingdom of God? Are people turning towards this coming kingdom? I was 17 years old when the Uniting Church came into being. I was involved in many of the youth activities of the wider church. I'd observed much of the excitement about the future. I remember growing up in a Methodist church in country South Australia. Our local church booked out the town hall and invited the whole town to come and celebrate this church union. I was doubly excited because, along with other young people from our church, we were to be baptized in the weeks following church union. The whole community traipsed off to the local Church of Christ because they had an immersion bath in their sanctuary. It was exciting being baptized into the faith, into the excitement of this period of church union. And in a real ecumenical spirit, holding this celebration, not in our own church, but in the neighbouring Church of Christ. As we were planning this service in our minister's huddle, Lucas told us he was not even born when the Uniting Church came into union. And indeed, in reality, for most of those aged under about 50, church union has been a story that has been inherited rather than lived through. For those in the post-baby boom generation, the Uniting Church is valued not because of any loyalty to pre-union traditions, not because of any direct participation in the struggle for union, but for what the Uniting Church has or has not come to be. It's valued on the basis of its authenticity and faithfulness to its mission, life, and witness. Is the Uniting Church walking the talk? Or is there some mismatch between what we say we believe and how we live our collective life together? My personal fear is that over the 43 years, we've become more timid, less courageous in living our collective life as a gift for others, and more concerned about the mechanics of survival. What if we became more reckless for the kingdom? At Union in 1977, the Uniting Church made a statement to the nation, a statement about what this new church would commit itself to be in the sphere of public social witness. I won't read the statement, but I would encourage you to seek it out and read it. But some of the things that the church told the wider Australian community that we would be on about, that we would stand up for, is that we would stand against injustice. We'd stand up and defend the value of human life. We'd stand up for integrity in public life. We'd stand up for citizen participation that was authentic, for religious liberty, for the eradication of poverty, for racial justice, for just access to education, healthcare, employment, for environmental justice. I'd like to suggest that standing up for these things is what gets many Christians and people of faith in other parts of the world in deep trouble. It's often what causes the powers to threaten their very lives. How are the powers responding to us? Are they shaking? Are they angry? Or couldn't they care less? As we planned this service together, we were clear that we did not want to be triumphalist, because we're aware that there are many shortcomings in the life of our church. But we didn't want to be pessimistic, because we're aware that there are things that are special and distinctive about the Uniting Church that we really need to celebrate. But my question is kind of different. Why is our experience so different from that described in Matthew's Gospel? Where are the fearful wolves? Where are the authorities that would attack us? Where are the conflicts that arise because we seek first the kingdom of God? Have we grown complacent? Are we too timid in our public witness and in witnessing to our faith? Have we become irrelevant? Does Australian society see that we have tasted the abundant life that God promises? Or do they look at us as bland and unexcited about the faith we hold? It's interesting that the statement to the nation concludes with a recognition of God's ultimate claim on us. Finally, the statement reads, "We affirm that the first allegiance of Christians is God, under whose judgment the policies and actions of all nations must pass." We realise that sometimes this allegiance may bring us into conflict with the rulers of our day. For those who are courageous enough to live this life of first allegiance to God, then there are comforting words in our passage from Matthew. Promises of intimate concern and care for those who courageously identify with Jesus and his kingdom message. In the portion of Matthew that we have read this morning, we are told three times to not be afraid. We're told how, being claimed by God, then there is nothing that can, in an ultimate sense, destroy us. And that God's concern for us is intimate and particular. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not the sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Friends, be courageous. Seek first the kingdom of God and drink deeply from the abundant life that kingdom has promised to us. Amen.
There's justice roll. This is how we pray. God, we thank you for this beautiful world you made, for the beauty and uniqueness of each country, for the different dialects and languages. Thank you for the sun that gives us heat and light and for growth, and for the moon that determines the ocean tides and for light and guidance by night. Thank you for rain that waters the earth, plentiful in places, in others very little. We think of those in countries where there is a poor supply of water, where people have to walk great distance to the only supply shared by the whole community. Also where there is a shortage of medical attention and supplies. There is so much upheaval and anger abounding in our world, as we see on the news, the violence and the destruction of buildings and businesses and destroying and defacing statues of dignitaries. Help the people of this world to look ahead, not dwell in the past. Caring God, we bring to you those persecuted and who have had to flee with very little of their possessions and move to refugee camps with no comfort and poor sanitation. We bring to you the injustices of the governments that occur to those unable to defend themselves, the racial hatred and abuse that is so rampant in many parts of this world. We yearn for all leaders of all countries that they turn to you for direction. Likewise, all who are in leadership. We bring to you countries affected and recovering from natural or man-made disasters which cause the loss of life and properties. We lift you all who throughout the world are affected by the coronavirus, that businesses will soon be able to open. Bless our country, our federal, state and local government leaders, that they do so with truth and justice. Bless our state Premier and the corruption he has to deal with within his cabinet, that the state of Victoria is their main priority. We bring to our farmers, as many have been struggling a long and severe drought and crippling taxes and fees. Likewise, the victims of the dreadful fires as they await compensation. We bring to you the underprivileged, the disabled, the abused, those struggling to make ends meet, the unemployed, the homeless. We bring to you the asylum seekers who have come to this country for a better life but hold up in detention centres with no government assistance and only known by a number. Please open the eyes of authorities that they may be treated with compassion. As we all cope with the current lockdown, we think of the lonely who have no family and no connections with anyone. We bring to our emergency workers, paramedics, police, fire officers, all health workers, doctors, nurses, therapists and cleaners, also teachers, lecturers and their students. Bless your churches in Maroondah, their ministers, church councils and their congregations. Thank you for our outreach to the community through our various activities and outlets. Bless those within our church families who are unwell, those recovering from surgery, those undergoing treatment. We thank you for family and friends to help us celebrate happy events and there to comfort us in times of sorrow. Let us have a time of silence as we bring to you those silent in our hearts. As we celebrate the church's birthday, although we can't meet in person, we are grateful for modern technology and able to log into this service. Bless those for this preparation. We bring to you our joys and concerns, gracious God, through your Son and our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Lord, have mercy on us. Hey guys, who wants to go to a birthday party?
Yay!
Yay! Yes! Come on, let's go, quick. Hey, oh my goodness. Did you ever see such a big, enormous cake?
No.
Someone will have to come around this side to have a look. Oh my goodness, look. It's got a number 4 and a number 3 up the top. Someone's telling me something. Listen. It's someone's birthday. Do you know someone that's 43? No. Turn around so your mum can see your lovely smiley face. Do you know someone that's 43?
No.
No, you're 3. My goodness, it's the Uniting Church. Hooray! Shake it around. Yep. Hey! Oh, very good. Oh my goodness. Who would like to cut the cake?
Me.
You'll find a knife over there. Can you see a knife?
Yes.
Be very careful. Which cake are you going to cut?
Oh,
just a minute. I forgot to light the candles. Here we go.
I know.
Yeah, we've got to be fair. Very careful when we light the candles because we don't want to knock the candles onto the cake.
My brother's lighting. My brother's going to cut the knife.
Your brother's going to cut the cake. I'm going to watch. Oh my goodness, which one are you going to cut? That's a good one. Yeah.
A rainbow.
You got to cut right through it. And then we say, happy birthday to everyone in the Uniting Church. Hooray! Push it all the way down. Oh, that's fantastic. Now you pull the knife out.
I wouldn't try cuts.
Fantastic. Yeah. Could you help me sing happy birthday?
Yes.
Turn around. Here we go. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to the Uniting Church. Happy birthday to you. Oh, here we go. Watch out. Oh, something's going to happen. Oh, I think that's what happened. We might have to poke a hole in the top. Whoops. That's okay. We can edit. Oh, my goodness. Look at all those things. Everything went everywhere. Oh my goodness! Happy birthday to the Uniting Church! Is there any more? I think there might be. I think there might. Quick, you can over there and I'll dump it on you. Quick, you get over there. Quick, here, over here in the middle. Quick, here we go. Oh my goodness! Oh! Hey! Toot, toot, toot! Happy birthday! Oh, fantastic. I think that'll be it. Lovely.
Can I have it? So I'm cutting the cake.
You can have a go cutting a cake. Of course you can. Oh, there's cake for everybody. And I'll hold my fingers here. Now you pull the cake out. You pull the knife out very good. We are. How about that, hey? Who wants to eat some of the cake?
Me.
Here we are. You ready? Let's film you eating cake. Oh, where's your cake? It's this one here, isn't it? Are you ready? You've got to turn around for the camera. You got to eat your cake. Oh, yum. That looks, do you think I could have one too? Can I have one? Do you think I'll make a mess? Do you think it'll get stuck in my moustache? It'll get stuck? Oh, this is yum. Happy birthday.
I found it.
It's good to celebrate a birthday, isn't it? Because a birthday is something very special. It only happens every year, doesn't it? Very nice. So happy birthday to everyone that's watching from all the Uniting Churches in the whole of Australia, isn't it, right?
Yeah.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Bye.
Thank you for joining us for worship this morning. We hope you found it enlightening, stirring, thought-provoking, humbling, and affirming. Thank you, as always, to everyone who's contributed to today's service. Though our situation remains difficult, we are nonetheless blessed by the gifts and graces of so many people who, in so many ways, enable us to continue to meet together in our several locations as communities of God. And so as we prepare to conclude our worship this morning, let us once more come before the grace of God. Let us pray. Children of God, follow the path of faithful discipleship, returning ever and always to the way of the Lord. For this is the road to eternal life. Trust in Christ, live by the power of the Holy Spirit, and surrender yourself to the love of God. And may God uphold you when life threatens to overwhelm. May Christ restore you when burdened by the knowledge of brokenness. May the Spirit kindle within you the desires of kingdom life. And may you always go into the world, blessed in the name of the Holy Triune God of our faith, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our worship is concluded. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you. His face to shine upon you.